Hello everybody, I would like to welcome you on my presentation about OpenStack in Kubernetes delivered by OpenStack Salt. First, I would like to speak about how to actually use our containers OpenStack within your own laptop. So it's for like development purposes for you who are used to go with background stuff. We are going to use Docker Compose instead, and in the second part I will go to our Kubernetes cluster and do some more deep dive about the stuff that Jacob and Michael showed before. Okay, my name is Marcello and I am Chief Network Architect at TCP Cloud, and currently I am also on the team that is responsible for getting OpenStack into containers and running on top of the Kubernetes. Okay, you probably saw this slide earlier, but I have to mention it again. The whole thing is based on OpenStack Salt, and we actually did it without any big changes in our formulas. There were just minor changes, and so that we can actually start the Docker Salt project about like 2 weeks ago, because we don't have to change our existing deployment tools. We just use what we had, and we just build the CI/CD pipeline to create the containers, and we together upload the Docker Hub. Alright, so that's where I start with the first demonstration, and I go to our GitHub and to the Docker Salt repository to just show you how you can. Can you see it? Okay. You can actually build your containers just with running this command. Without running this command, you can also download the images from our Docker Hub. It's okay. It's faster. Then there is a file. I'm currently on my repo, and if I go to the compose, there is a file. Come on, and where are incremental variables? That actually replaces the values in the configuration files with these IP addresses. We use it because of the Kubernetes. As you can see, something like this is a Kubernetes notation, how they create automatically incremental variables when you create a Kubernetes service. This incremental variables is shared among all containers, so they can actually do this variable and place it into configuration files. So we are actually like IP plan independent. I'll go back to it when I go to the Kubernetes. But we want to run it locally, so we need to the stuff to simulate the Kubernetes environment, so we have to do it from this environmental file. So you just replace the IP addresses from in this file with your own IP address on your laptop, and then you just run the Docker Compose. Okay, you have to start with the Compose core, which is like support in the support services like Mcache, MySQL. The database is already listening, so Slack services. As you can see, it's already created the containers. So I can go, for example, into Keystone. I can source my identity and okay, we have to wait for a while. The first run of the Keystone takes some time because it is creating the tables in the database. So okay, as you can see, there are great user being created right now. Alright. So there is as well the open control compose file. You can create the open control as well. As well as the what?
Content of compose files.
Yeah. For example. Okay. You can see what's going on. Alright, so this was the first part, and I'll go back to my presentation. I would like to continue with the high availability stuff. And the first slide is about the technology we use to get it all working. I use the terminology underlay, not just for the networking, but I mean for the underlying infrastructure that the OpenStack is running on, and it means the Kubernetes cluster together with Calico for networking. And on top of this Kubernetes and Calico cluster runs our OpenStack with OpenContrail as SDN solution. We have to consider what networking plugin we use for Kubernetes. We can use Contrail as well, but we were just thinking why we need to bring the complexity and the bunch of features that Contrail provides to Kubernetes, because how are we deploying the OpenStack now? You probably have like one VLAN, two VLANs, or just simple routing infrastructure. So I think it suits well. And I think that Calico brings all we need, all the features we need, and it's simple, simple to deploy, simple to manage. And it's used only the networking. There is no overlay with Calico. It uses like /32 routes, and they are using BERT to exchange the routing information. You can extend it to your physical networking stuff via BGP or BGP is used best, but I think you can use OSPF or something like that as well because it's BERT. And that's why we didn't use the Flannel, because the Flannel is simple as well, but it's Flannel uses the VXLAN as encapsulation, and we didn't need to run the OpenStack control traffic through the VXLAN tunnels. We don't need it. So now it's Calico or Flannel, in future probably both, because they are going to merge together in one project. So, alright, there is also a transformation from the stuff you have right now. You probably do the balancing and high availability of your OpenStack services with HAProxy and KeepAlive, but you don't need that with the Kubernetes, because with the Kubernetes you have the high availability by design. It's because of the Kubernetes service objects that actually are connected to pods via labels. And each Kubernetes node balance on each pod of the cluster. So traffic can go to each node of the Kubernetes cluster, and it balances it to all his members.
What is used for balancing?
What is used for balancing? With Calico you use the IP tables, but I think there is also possibility for user space balancing. Alright, in the previous slide you saw that I have a keystone pods, not a keystone container, because the Kubernetes deliver another resource. It's not a container, but the smallest unit is pod, and it's a bunch of containers that is using, for example, the networking namespace and stuff like that. So, for example, when you have a Nova controller, you have like six different Docker containers that share the networking namespace, etc. etc. Okay, and this is the infrastructure we used for the demo. We have one submaster which delivers the configuration management for the Kubernetes cluster as well as the manifest for deploying the OpenStack. Then we have the Kubernetes master, which is currently running with a single node for the demo, but for the production environment there is no problem to deploy the Kubernetes cluster. It's just about clustering the etcd key value store and that's it. And then we have three Kubernetes physical nodes for OpenStack and OpenContract controllers, and two Kubernetes nodes for OpenStack and OpenContract computes. Okay. I think that I actually spoke about this in previous slide, so we can go to do another demo. So. So it was automated as well. We just reused what we had, and can see that Kubernetes can manage the cluster volumes and mount it into the containers. So it's mounted in the all three Kubernetes containers. And if I go to the service, for example, or to the deployment, it's really simple. You just define under the volumes, the name, the type of the volume, and the Kubernetes knows how to manage the cluster. Okay. So now I would like to go to the services, for example. Which are like the balancing for our OpenStack services. And for example, if I use our Keystone to get more information about it, you can see that it has the three endpoints. These endpoints are the Keystone pods, and the pods are getting connected to the service through this selector, Kubernetes use the key value pairs metadata to connect the pods to the services. So when you start a new service with this key value, it gets under the endpoints immediately. So you don't need to do anything. I would like to show you also the networking. As you can see, we have the Calico running everywhere. They have the BGP established together. What actually happens, each node gets a slice of the predefined IP address, for example, /26. And on the node where the containers are running, they are like a host row /32 for each container. So this is all over the Kubernetes nodes. When you want to expand it to your, for example, hardware network, you just start a BGP peering with the Calico nodes, and then you can get it also into your legacy nodes. Okay, so now I'm just thinking about whether my cluster is still running. So I'll try Keystone. Glance is working. I'll try Neutron. Okay, and Mola as well, because the Jacob and Lucky actually didn't boot instance or something like that. They just create a network. So probably we can try whether the OpenStack is working correctly. So I think that I have already. Okay, we can upload the image. Okay, so we have image, we have network, we can try to boot the instance. Alright, I need to just replace the net ID. Alright, I'll reply to this test and I'll boot it on the request. Okay, thanks. As you can see, my instance is up and running. I'll put the second instance as well on the second node. So we have as well the Libvirt and Nova Compute running in the Kubernetes. So I'll, for example, can look whether instance is running in the Libvirt with kubectl exec ID. Okay, you see the one instance is running. So now I'm going to show one more control feature, and that is that when you put the instance, it actually creates like a link local address under the system. So there is a way how to connect to your instance from the host system. So it was a Cirrus, so I think this is like the credentials are like some yes, okay. And the password is alright, as you can see I'm already in my instance. The address is exactly the same as I expect. And I can try to ping the instance on another node, and as you can see it's perfectly working. So our OpenStack in Kubernetes works perfectly, so what time do I have? I have like 5 more minutes. So I probably leave just some time for questions. Okay, no questions about the OpenStack in Kubernetes. Yeah, of course you can.
Can you see all the examples from several data centers?
Sorry?
You can scale from several data centers, for example, or to different cloud providers.
I don't think that I catch your question. Do you mean that if I can, I have, for example, Keystone running, if I can scale Keystone.
Start deployment, the environmental variables in
replaced by the IP addresses of the services. So you can take it, you can put it into another data center, run these manifests as they are, and you will get your OpenStack cluster up and running. Okay, so I think I'm done. Any more questions? You mean the changes in the formulas, or
yeah,
you basically need to just add the entry points for the Docker images. So when you start the Docker images, they start an entry point which executes the salt and replaces the variables. Okay, Jacob is going to find it right now. That's the entry point schedule we just add to every formula. I think that it's the only change we did. Yeah, as well. Okay, so I think we're done. Right, if anyone has some more questions, I'll be here for the rest of the day, so you're welcome to stop and ask.